everyone. Welcome to Yin Radio. I'm your host, Hilary Raimo. Applying the principles of Chinese medicine and shamanism to build a healing relationship with the earth. That's what we're talking tonight with author GAIL'S. She wrote a book called Earth Acupuncture, Healing the Living Landscape. And her story is incredible, inspiring, and you're going to learn a lot tonight. After experiencing a powerful vision of the nuclear power plant near her home and its toxic effects on the Hudson River, acupuncturist GAIL'S was inspired to help heal the river and surrounding lands, but was unsure how to begin. Her story starts with a workshop with a 27th generation Cherokee wisdom teacher, Venerable Dayani Yawahu. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. She discovered the answer. She could treat the landscape just as she treated her patients by taking its pulses and treating the points of stagnant energy and pollution with acupuncture. Tracing her journey from initial vision and pulse taking to building a stone circle to open a major energy meridian of the Hudson, GAIL reveals how our rivers, valleys, and forests are capable of illness and healing just like a living being. She explains simple practices in her book for attuning with the living landscape and responding appropriately to the messages and images received from the earth's intelligence. By making offerings of thanks and asking the land's permission before every interaction, GAIL'S demonstrates the power of right relationship in motion. I'm really excited to talk about this tonight. GAIL'S is an acupuncturist, author, and editor, a graduate of the University of Pennsylvania and the Tri-State College of Acupuncture. She has been practicing Chinese medicine since 1995, first in New York and now in Vermont, and she is the author of another book called Wood Becomes Water, Chinese Medicine in Everyday Life. Welcome, GAIL. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks, Hilary. I'm glad to be on the show.
This is a really incredible story. I must say, I really thoroughly enjoyed reading your book, and I'm just, you know, so grateful for the journey that you took and for putting it into book form and sharing it with all of us. You know, for the listeners who haven't read your book, where do you want to start? How do you want to introduce your incredible, profound work to my listeners?
Well, let's start with that vision, which came as a surprise to me. I was sitting in a meditation class, and all of a sudden, there's no other word to describe it. I had a vision. I saw. It was as if I was in the air looking down from a mountain at the Hudson River right near the Indian Point nuclear power plant. And I saw these like lines of fire moving from the power plant into the Hudson River and into the land below the river. And it just sort of was this volcanic, fiery, dark wound that was happening. And I realized, the river is hurt, and it's showing me its pain. And then I heard this voice in my head that said, what you are given to see, you can heal. Work with the hills. And then I sort of became aware again of the room that I was sitting in and what everyone else was doing in the meditation workshop, and I was stunned. I had never had such an experience happen to me before, and it changed my life.
Well, it's clear that it did in your book, and one of the things that drew me to wanting to bring you on the air to talk to you about this topic was the fact that the Indian Point nuclear, the power plant near your home that you worked so hard to heal is now in the headlines, you know, saying that there are leaks happening and that more damage is being done in this area. So there couldn't be more of a right timing, as far as I'm concerned, to bring you on the air to share your story, to get people to understand that they too can have a role in healing the landscape. I don't know if people might put together the art of acupuncture along with with earth healing, but you have done a wonderful job of showing and proving how this energy work can be applied to the earth. So when you started to go out into the land to find your pulse points, which is part of how you began your process, you were looking for something called the dragon's bad breath. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Yes, when I was a few months after that initial vision, it came to me that the way that I needed to heal this landscape was to build a stone circle, kind of like the old hinges in Britain, but perhaps smaller, and that that would function as acupuncture for the earth. And I was in a workshop with Venerable Dahani Oahu, and I just sort of announced during a question and answer period that I was thinking of building a stone circle to help heal the landscape around Indian Point, and did she have any suggestions? And, lo and behold, she did. And one of her suggestions was that I should find the place where the dragon exhales its bad breath, and that's where I should build my circle. And that was one of several things that she said, but that was kind of the most absorbing thing initially, because it's so poetic and dramatic and mythical, this dragon's bad breath. And I didn't know, once I began to look around, what such a thing would be, right? Where was I going to find a dragon, and what would its bad breath look like? But the very first day that I went exploring, I went across the river, the opposite side of the nuclear power plant, to just go have a look at it from the other side of the river. And as I was driving through the landscape, I suddenly got this horrible, sick feeling in my body that I didn't know how to describe, but I didn't know if I was going to, I didn't feel actually nauseous, but my stomach was pulling tight and I got a headache across the front of my head. And in another minute, I was suddenly looking at the Indian Point nuclear power plant just across the river. And it was huge from that vantage point. And there was smoke coming out of it. There was this little town right on my side of the river, was this tiny little, must have once been beautiful, but this at this point a little run down, sad seeming little village that just seemed blighted, for lack of a better word. Like, here it is in, you know, one of the most prosperous counties in the whole state, in the whole country, in fact. But here is this little dark spot. Huh. And so I realized that, in fact, this was the place of the dragon's bad breath. This was where the power plant was exuding its poisons, right there in the river. And there's this pool at that point in the river where the tides, so the water comes down from the north and rushes through the Hudson Highlands, which is a narrow and steep canyon, and the water comes through there very, very quickly. And then all of a sudden, the riverbed widens out, and the water kind of comes to a crashing, not quite a stop, but its velocity really changes because it's no longer rushing through this steep and narrow canyon. It's now in this wide bay. And at the same time, the Hudson, which is a tidal river, so there's tides coming up from the Atlantic Ocean miles below, but when the tide is coming in, the water is actually coming upriver. So it comes up the river and meets this kind of stagnant pool right at Indian Point, and there that water sits for quite some time. So all of that bad breath that's coming out of that dragon doesn't really move away.
Interesting. And also, when you made your circle, you had quite the interesting time figuring out how to take the pulse of the land like you would take the pulse of a client. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I was really working blind because it was not something I had ever done before. It was not something I had ever heard about before. It was just a completely novel idea. So I didn't really know what to do, but I just kind of started by looking at a map and deciding, well, I guess I would want to look in public parks because I didn't want to be, I certainly couldn't go to someone's house and take a pulse there. So I would look for places that were public parks. And Dehani Oahu had given me the advice to look for pulse points at 3 miles and 6 miles and 9 miles away from the power plant, which is analogous to the three fingers that I put on my on a client's wrist to feel their pulses. I feel a different pulse under each finger. So the 3 mile zone and the 6 mile zone and the 9 mile zone would be roughly analogous to that. And after a while I realized that, oh, water is the way to feel a pulse. I need to be near water in these public parts because water moves the way that blood moves in a blood vessel. So that's where I might find a pulse. So I identified likely spots on my map, and then I started to go around to them, and I didn't really know what to do once I got there because I wasn't sure how I was going to feel a pulse of a landscape. And at first I tried to feel a real pulse the way I would feel a person's pulse, but the river itself didn't seem to be doing anything that I could identify as a pulse. So then I just started to relax and let what came to mind come through. And what I began to see was just images sometimes of people, sometimes weak people, sometimes an overbearing sensation, sometimes I would have other little visions of birth and rebirth. And at each spot, I came away with a pretty clear pulse reading that came to me in a different way than a human pulse, but that once I began to analyze its qualities, had in fact qualities that were very similar to a human pulse, like weak and thready, or slippery, or tight. So it began to, the metaphor that I had thought was just going to be a cute metaphor about taking the pulses of the land started to seem really very similar to taking pulses on a person.
Hmm. And that, you know, when you were talking earlier about the dragon's breath being bad, it reminds me of how we can sometimes tell the health of inside of a human body by someone's halitosis, or if they have really bad breath or something going on inside their body that's not quite in alignment with health. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely, yes.
Yeah, and so when you talk about the comparison between the acupressure, you know, the acupuncture points, putting the three fingers on the wrist, plotting out the three circles at the given amounts of distance, finding the areas by water. I mean, it's almost like you're inside of a human body and you're tracking these telltale signs of the landscape. And I've never lived near a nuclear power plant, but I know people who have, and I've also heard stories that, you know, the areas are often economically depleted. They have a very low status of income and IQ and things of that sort. There's just some kind of stagnant energy there along with the humans. So it would make perfect sense that we have this mirrored type, you know, alignment between the two, and comparing one versus the other can often give us a diagnosis of the other, don't you think? Yeah.
It was a new idea to me at the time. In hindsight, it makes perfect sense. But mostly in Chinese medicine, we do it the other way around. We use nature to help understand what's going on with the humans. And so this was
So it does complement each other. And you had an original idea to compare the art of acupuncture to the landscape. I don't think anybody has done that officially, have they?
Not as far as I know. I have heard of people who do things called earth acupuncture, and where they put rods or stones or whatnot or crystals in the earth. But I don't know of another acupuncturist who actually uses the systems and the models and the theories of acupuncture to do it.
Yeah. Well, your lines, the 3 points that you mapped out around Indian Point power plant, was associated with the kidney, the lung, I believe, and the heart. The kidney, the liver, excuse me, the liver. I know it was an L.
So all of them. It's so they're the kind of the main organs used in Chinese medicine, and they each organ has a reflection in one of the pulse positions. So there's depending on what system you use, you can find 6 or 12 or even sometimes 18 different pulses reflecting different organs. I simplified it for my purposes down to the main 6. So the heart, the spleen and kidney yin, and the lungs and the liver and kidney yang.
I was fascinated when I read that story. I was fascinated by your visions at each location, how you described what you saw in your book. And people should go read the book to find those out. We don't want to give everything away on the show. But, I mean, really, the stories and the visions and the things that you experienced were quite profound and very, very insightful. I have not read another book on this kind of work with acupuncture by anybody. I've never seen it. So when this title crossed my path, I said, wow, that's really interesting, because I've been working with meditation and nature through my Love Breathe for Earth platform, and I've been taking groups of people out into the woods, into different natural areas to meditate, to talk about the effects of that. So, you know, I'm working with meditation and nature, you're working with acupuncture and nature, and what you're revealing is a very profound intelligence. You're actually aligning your human knowledge with the earth's knowledge and performing a healing through the level of consciousness. Now, you didn't just do this alone. You started to work with a man named James, mm-hmm. who was acting as like a yin-yang. So can you talk to us about the yin-yang importance and how this affects the energy work that you were doing?
Well, in Chinese medicine, yin and yang is the primary duality that from when everything was just one big whole and then things divided into these two poles, yin and yang. And almost everything in Chinese medicine is viewed through that lens of some things are very young and have a lot of bright, effervescent energy. Some things are very yin and have sort of a darker, condensing, contemplative energy. And as I set about, as I had done a few pulses on my own, and then it was the day when I had decided I should be looking for the kidney yang pulse, and I realized that I just had no idea how to go about looking for kidney yang, because I am just not a very yang personality. I'm quiet, I'm contemplative, I'm slow moving and slow talking, and that kind of burning, bright, young, get a lot done energy is kind of mysterious to me. And so I decided that I should actually find a partner, someone who could be the young part of this, so that we could be really doing a complete circuit of energy, that it was imbalanced to just be looking from one viewpoint. We needed the other part.
So I had a friend who was also an acupuncturist who was willing to go on these adventures with me, and that made a great change and allowed a whole different kind of energy and viewpoint to come through.
You know, I have to say, I really think your work is the foundation of a future science. I really believe that. After reading your book and listening to your story and listening to you talk tonight, I think, you know, future generations are going to look back and see your book as very important because you've introduced an original idea into human consciousness through the comparison of nature and acupuncture, and then going and actually doing it and walking the land and praying on the land and meditating on the land and working on the land with a partner, all in conscious, mindful knowledge of what you just spoke about, I think is really profound, and I think it's going to change humanity if they get their act together and start paying attention to it.
I certainly hope so, and in fact, it is really already happening, right? Maybe it's not always happening with acupuncture, but there's people like you and me and, you know, I've met probably a dozen others at this point, and I'm sure there are more, who are understanding that the earth speaks, if only we will listen. And I'm
so in love with this show right now, Gail. I'm just sitting over here with a big smile on my face because you're probably the most refreshing conversation I've had in a long, long, long time. So I have to say thank you, first of all. But that said, and, you know, looking forward into where we're going and what we're headed into, it's almost like looking backwards to the time when they built all the megaliths across the planet. Because as you describe the energy systems of this work, you know, and talking about building the stone circle and putting that into place and placing crystals into the ground and working with the energy grids, I mean, when you start measuring the megaliths across Europe, you start to and actually measuring them, going there and measuring them, not just relying on Google Earth, because those things aren't always right. But when you start going there and measuring them and you start applying the mathematics that the stone circles were laid out in, you can then bridge something even bigger into the acupuncture meeting. And I'm curious if you contemplated or mused on that topic at any point in your own building when you were putting those pieces of stone into place, if you thought about our ancestors and the people who used to put all of these things up and put all the messages and the healing, you know, knowledge and technology into these sites.
Oh, absolutely.
Exactly what you just did.
I absolutely thought about that, and I had the help of two really powerful geomancers in this project. One of them, Ivan Macbeth, is a modern-day druid who has built giant stone circles all over the world. And he is really a Celtic spirit, and he, more than anyone else I've ever met, really understands the work involved and the precision involved and the cosmic conversation involved in creating something like this. And it really does tie you in to all those ancestors who ever did that before, and especially to all those ancestors who knew and understood that we are having a conversation with all of creation, and that this is a way for humans, by creating something that stands and reflects the precision of the universe, this is a way for humans to speak back.
Oh, yes. Absolutely, yes. You write something very interesting in your book. I'm going to read it. You write, "Our linear concept of time is thus introducing a cancerous consciousness into our dealings with each other and our environment. In contrast, circular time awareness brings us back to living in a renewable relationship in so many parts of our life and activities." I have to say that was probably one of the most profound aha moments I had in your book. I had many, actually, but this was one of the first ones. Because I don't want to take time away from what you have to say because it's very important, but I just want you to understand that this was very profound. And when I read it and I thought to myself, she just solved the problem. She just solved the problem because she just told us what it is. You clearly gave it in your words in this book a whole new level of understanding that I have not seen in other people's work. I was very, very touched by it. Could you talk to us a little bit about what you were thinking and feeling when you wrote that?
I could, except that, in fact, that particular section is from the foreword by Patrick McManaway. So it was his words, although they certainly...
Well, I'm sorry. My apologies for not getting them. I love them anyway.
I love them, too, and I...
What do they mean to you? Talk to us about that.
Pardon?
What do those words mean to you? Talk to us a little bit about that.
Well, that, in fact, our culture made a big wrong turn somewhere. Several thousand years ago, where we started to believe that time was, in fact, linear and that things kept moving forward and growing, and that somehow we have that model for our economy as well, that everything's supposed to keep growing all the time in this forward way and get to something and achieve something. But really, in point of fact, that is exactly what cancer does. Cancer keeps growing. Cancer moves forward and destroys everything behind it. But it's not a healthy growth. Healthy growth is growth in balance with your surroundings. So, and in concert with your surroundings. And so Patrick's point in the foreword is that there are many traditional societies around the world who have this concept of circular time, that it is not, in fact, a moving forward of progress, but it's a spiral in which we rediscover and repeat and reinvent our relationships every time we go around the wheel. And so that's a much more sustainable paradigm because it includes everything.
Wow, that's pretty profound. Thank you for sharing that with us. Appreciate that. That's something to reflect on for sure for all of us. Now, that said, and then moving back into your work with this particular area of the Hudson River, which, by the way, I live in Albany, so this is very close to home for me as well. So this is a really interesting timing and story, because as you were writing this and actually doing all of this, I went looked back in my life and said, well, where was I at when she was doing this? And I was going through a very, very deep healing time. So I'm curious how people are affected through a level of consciousness, you know, when people like you are doing this work and tracking this and then plotting it out and doing the visions and saying the prayers and building the stone circles, how that's affecting people's healing process. Have you any thoughts on that?
I have thoughts, but no real evidence. Yeah, I mean, I do think that the more tuned in people are with their surroundings, the more responsive they are to what's happening around them. So it seems to me likely that a lot of people in that time and place would have shifted subtly or not so subtly in their thoughts and behaviors and experiences. And I know that there are people doing similar kinds of work around the world who actually will measure things like crime statistics or high school graduation rates or crop yields to gauge whether a healing has had a broad effect like that across the time space.
That would be a great experiment for big data to focus their positive energy on, don't you think?
Wouldn't it? That would be
right?
Awesome.
I mean, I just thought about that as you said that. I said, you know, if only the NSA would wake up and do good things, maybe that would be a great way to redeem all the negativity they've thrown out into the world.
It would certainly give us so much to work with.
Yeah, I have a question. You also talk about geophysics and telluric currents. Could you talk to us a little bit about those?
So these energies that I was working with earth acupuncture, I certainly didn't invent them. There are cultures throughout time and all around the world that have understood that there is energy in the earth and around the earth and above the earth, and people give it different names. Kind of a name that's becoming current these days is just to talk about geopathic stress as being disturbed earth energy. But there are other, I mean, when people talk about ley lines or, I don't know what else, miasma or chi or prana, it's all the same. It just occurs at different levels. There are Celtic traditions that identify different spirits. Like we'll talk about devas who are little land spirits or fairy people who have relationships with humans. And so the energies have always been there. It's just whether our language and our culture is big enough to put names to it.
Well, there's certainly a lot of myths and stories about little people in the Native American traditions. They really do talk about that. So, you know, you did use shamanism as a way to communicate with nature, and they did too. And that, I think, has always been the big, deep, dark secret, you know, and why indigenous people are always attacked by, you know, big military industrial complexes, because they break a kind of brainwashing program, because they connect you back to earth frequency. You know, I have to say, I really enjoyed the part where you talked about the shape of Indian Point Energy Center, how it looked like a penis and testicles. And
yeah.
This is kind of what went through my mind as a reader, as I'm reading through, you know, your description of your adventure, and you're describing this. I'm thinking, isn't that really interesting how it's the point of the dragon's bad breath? And that the overrun patriarchy on the planet now, as it is defined by mainstream culture, is a very much cancerous, unsustainable kind of consciousness. So if you are seeing and perceiving this place as a male penis phallic type symbol, and it's spewing out this negative energy, you absolutely went in and healed this toxic dragon's breath patriarchal energy. And yeah, so then we have, yeah, that's how I see it. I mean, I don't know what you were thinking when you saw it, but when I read your story, that's what it sparked in me. It's a very beautiful story.
Well, thank you. It was a beautiful experience to live through, and I will say that since I was working on that land, the structure of the power plant has changed, and they have since taken down that tall tower in the middle that looked like a penis surrounded by testicles. So now there's just two breasts.
So now it's like removing the toxic feminine energy.
Uh-huh.
The feminine energy that really does plague consciousness both in men and women, that toxic feminine energy.
Absolutely.
What would you describe toxic feminine energy as?
Well, it can have a few different aspects, but one of them is just complete annihilation, like just that total overbearing, overprotecting, taking over everything. And another So that's sort of a corruption of that beautiful feminine tendency to take care of, or to care about, or to think about. But when it becomes unbalanced, it's over-controlling. And being over-critical as well. I think those are the two that come to mind. Can you think of others?
Well, yeah, it's like kind of like the dark womb, you know? It's like that demonized womb energy where the woman is just turned into that ranting, raving lunatic type, you know, archetype. That complete annihilation, the consumer of all good type thing.
Uh-huh.
And, I mean, when women turn dark, they get really nasty if they're not healed. If they are healed, I think they handle the dark in a different way. It's a lot different when it's handled in a healthy way versus the darker, negative way. So there's a toxic feminine energy that creeps into the landscape and mutates everything, and everyone thinks it's a new normal. And, you know, I don't know, I just think that there's a progression there that people have to pay attention to, and it's reflected in the landscape, and you could prove that through your work. You showed us that it's true, you know, with the work that you did. So what did you learn about yourself in this whole process? What was the personal journey mostly about for you, if you don't mind sharing?
I don't mind sharing. A lot of it is complicated to share, and I did as best I could to describe it in the book, but for me, the really profound part was just the realization that, in fact, we can communicate with rivers and with mountains, and that, in fact, we have an obligation to do so, and that once we begin that process of creating that relationship of conversing with the world around us, it wakes them up to the possibility as well. And so that I feel that we have it's our duty to begin to participate in the living of this planet, this beautiful planet. And that if we don't participate in the living, then we are, in fact, contributing to the dying. And which we see all around us every day in a thousand different horrible ways. And it can make us feel really helpless with diseases and global warming and all of these global problems, not to mention the wars and the abuses, but that, in fact, all we can do is all we have to do, which is to wake up and participate.
I think that's a great thing. It's a great vision, and I hope people really listen to what you just said. You talk about an idea of spirit of place in your book. Talk to us a little bit about what it means to appreciate the spirit of place.
Well, this is a concept, again, that is found in a lot of cultures around the world, and there are different names for it, but it's kind of you can think of it as the sum total of the energies of the beings that are in a particular place. Or sometimes there's an overarching being, like, for instance, the Hudson River running through that landscape. That river has its own spirit, and it flavors the landscape all around it in a myriad ways. And there is nothing like a river town. And you can tell when you are near the river or farther away from the river, just from not just the species that are around you, but also just the feel of the place. So the spirit of place includes all that goes into it. But sometimes there's just some bigger characters than others.
What would you suggest to somebody who hasn't quite gotten back to their relationship with nature do to make a first step? So many of us live in a virtual, digital type of reality. We don't spend a lot of time outside, let alone meditating or appreciating nature, because we're so busy and we have like a virtual reality around us where it kind of artificially replaces it for the most part. How do you get people out of that artificial matrix back into the natural world?
You just need to go outside. I mean, it can't be done indoors. Even looking out a nice window doesn't get you there. But, you know, it's very simple and very hard at the same time. If you have a busy life, and particularly if you're a city dweller and there's not a lot of, it doesn't seem like there's a lot of natural world around you, but in fact stepping outside is really the way to begin. And the more time you spend out of doors, the more of a relationship you build. It's kind of automatic, because you start to replace the constructions of your mind, the constructions of your screen, the constructions of your job become replaced with trees, grass, birds. Even in cities, you can find these things. Parks are better, but if you don't live near a park, there's probably a tree or two or some birds. The more time you spend looking, the more you learn. And the more you remember that you were once a part of it, and the more you long to become a part of it again.
Talk to us a little bit about the birds in your work. When you are doing all of this shamanic healing, actuality, all of this stuff put into motion, the actual experience of it, did you notice any change in the bird song?
That's a really good question. I only in the sense that I worked on this project for the better part of a year. It was really 9 months, and so the seasons changed, and so the bird life changed. But I wasn't. That's an interesting question. It would have been fun to have a bird person really paying attention.
Yeah. Somebody who's really good at it that can identify the different kinds and the migration patterns. That would be really neat to figure out how that changes over the health and the landscape of the land. How would that translate into the human body with chi? The migration of birdsong.
I would say, so if you think of birds as a part of the greater ecology, and some birds, for instance, are sort of like weedy species and they can kind of live in any environment, and then others are more sensitive and need things a little bit more stable. So with people, it's... when we are, the better our health is, the kind of more everything begins to function more smoothly. So when you are in fine form, perhaps you have more intuition, or you're better able to recognize your intuitions, or you have really great creative ideas and are able to manifest them. So it's the signs of a smooth functioning system that start to appear as you begin to heal.
Huh. That's interesting. I wonder, If you ever track that, let me know. Or if you write another book on that, I'd love to read it. Because that's an interesting idea. Yeah, because birders spend a lot of time studying that stuff. They can identify them in a lot of interesting ways. And they fly according to the electromagnetics of the earth. So as those change and become cyclic, the birds sometimes track that. Which
yeah, that's true. I wasn't thinking about it, but it would really be a beautiful thing to pay attention to.
Huh. So we're out of, you know, we're kind of coming to the end of the show, and, you know, there's a lot more that you talk about in your book about your experience. I mean, we only touched on a really kind of surface basis of it. So if anybody's listening and you are interested in more, you really should buy your book and finish reading it yourself, because it's kind of like a pilgrimage of spirit. You go through layers of understanding that make a lot of sense. And, you know, you might see the world a little differently, a little bit more accurate. So in closing for the show, Gail, what do you have coming up where people can find you, or do you have any, what projects are you doing? What are you doing now?
Now I am working on acupuncturing people again, and I am starting work on another book, but I'm not quite ready to talk about that yet, but it is another book about healing. And I do have a website, which is GAIL'sRex.com, where people can learn a little bit more about the book as well as my first book. Or you can order the book through the website, and there's also information about my acupuncture practice, which will only be helpful to people who live near me, but that's a good way. I have a plan to start up a kind of web clearinghouse of earth healers, so that it's a like a one-stop collection of sites for people who practice various kinds of earth healing, like the work that you do or the work that other people do, where people can learn about what earth healing is and all the different many ways you can practice it. That's a little bit down the line, but that's something that...
Wow, that's exciting. That's exciting. That's going to become really important work, you know, in the future, especially for generations coming up in such a digital world. They really don't get exposed to nature the way that, you know, some of us have been, because we didn't have all the fancy technologies that are available today, and it's just going to get worse. So it worries me as an older person looking down at younger people that they don't forget what it is like to be out in nature and connect directly with that frequency versus not. And I wonder if some of the mental issues that we deal with, some of the social issues that we deal with, don't stem from a lack of connection to Earth. What do you think?
Yeah, I'm sure that that's true. And there have been a couple of books about that. I'm trying to remember one of them, specifically about kids losing their kind of nature literacy, but I forget what it's called and I forget the author, but there are, I think absolutely it's true that once we divorce ourselves from the divine model of how things work in concert, in relationship, then we become subject to all kinds of ills. And, well, we can heal those ills, and we can rediscover the relationship. And just begin by stepping outside, bring your kids outside.
Go outside is like the big ultimate message. Go outside.
Yeah.
Right now. It's like, go outside right now.
Yeah, look at the stars, even like on a cold night. I don't know, it's probably cold where you are. It's really cold here in Vermont tonight, but it's beautiful.
How do you see, okay, let's go to politics for a second. We're going to just shift the energy for a minute, because how do you see that realm of human interaction affecting that frequency of nature? It's like, do people focus more on negative energy and just miss earth energy? How do we deal with kind of, you know, having to see Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton on TV all the time and getting caught up in all these melodramas? How do we get out of the spell? How do you tell people, where do they start?
Well, they start by noticing how they feel when they are watching these people or listening to these people. There is a certain stomach-turning thing that happens when someone is not speaking truth. And you can feel that. And I think, again, when you go outside, nature doesn't dissemble, and the natural world doesn't lie. So once you get used to realizing that it is actually possible to act with integrity, then you can start to see the people who are not and the people who are more so. I think politics is a special case where, by its very nature, you're sometimes doing things you don't agree with in order to gather consensus and gather power. So it doesn't always mean only doing the things you believe in 100%, but it does mean speaking the truth. And you can tell who is speaking truth and who is being incendiary and who is trying to curry favor.
Yeah, you really can. It's kind of like the real, you know, live stream. You go outside and you're kind of connecting to the ground and the trees and the fresh air and the sun and the real light. There's a different feeling to that in your body, and I think that creates a different biochemistry, and then we start to change how we feel inside. There's a health that returns. Wouldn't you agree?
Absolutely, yes. And so once you know what that feels like, you look for it, and you connect with other people who feel that same thing. And then we start to shift the character of what's going on as more and more people bond together in this sense of health and truth.
Do you see that as a saving grace for humanity at this point? A change in sustainable consciousness is really what's necessary?
Yeah, I think that's about the almost the only option available to us right now. The other ones are slow-moving and politically hamstrung, and it's not going to be enough to just change the laws or just stop the pollution. What has to happen is that deep internal change of recognizing that this is the planet we have. And if we lose it, we lose everything. And therefore, let's save it.
Right. Why not? That's why not live a beautiful, healthy, happy life aligned with what makes you happy and makes you feel love.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand why people fight that so much. It's like the control factor on this planet is really, it needs to give up. Just let it flow, just like nature would. And we see that reflected in people who are doing the work like you are. Earth Acupuncture Healing the Living Landscape. I've been talking to Gail Rex. If you'd like to know more, go read her book or get a hold of her and maybe ask her your own questions. Gail, thanks so much for joining me tonight. It's been a pleasure to talk to you.
It's been a joy, Hillary. Thank you so much.
I really enjoyed it. I learned a lot. Thanks for listening, everybody. I'm Hillary Raimo, and this is Yin Radio TV. Good night.